This video is sponsored by ABC Leisure Group for everything to do with canal boats, marina moorings, hire boating, brokerage, chandleries, and off-grid electrical equipment. This is Ferris, the most unusual canal boat I've ever been aboard. Designed in the style of an inspection launch, it is nonetheless a family narrowboat, and apart from the hull, was nearly all hand-built by one man, Edwin Fasham. The novelty starts with the stainless steel and aluminium superstructure. A giant sliding hatch covers an open rear deck where there are seats, as well as the most retro-futuristic controls you'll ever see. There's no word on whether it goes back in time if it reaches 8.8 knots, but frankly, I wouldn't be surprised. There's surely a flux capacitor around here somewhere. And yes, those really are the engine controls and gauges. Those levers control ahead, astern, and the speed. And, genius, there's a foot throttle as well, so you don't need to take your hands off the tiller. The inside is no less extraordinary, though at first glance the saloon looks conventional enough, apart from all the windows. But there are clever little touches that set this boat aside, such as the detachable steps, which slide into their own custom holder, which turns the space under the forward deck into a bed area. Well, if you remove the solar panel, that is. There's bedding stored under the boards. Glorious, vintage-style lights adorn the roof, but the bulbs are the latest LED technology. Behind the saloon is the galley. Seems standard enough initially, with a sink and mugs on shelves. There's a workspace on the other side and a fridge. But hang on, look at the cooker! It's a custom diesel-fired range with a custom kettle too, designed to fit into that hole directly above the diesel flame. Stove controls are, as you might now expect, vintage. It doesn't take long for the kettle to boil. Less conventional for a galley would be a solar control panel. But way more so even than that is the vintage engine in the kitchen. Yes, really. That's a Gardner 3LW, and it's very shiny and loud. It's probably time we met the inspired inventor of this incredible boat, Edwin Fasham, who's still tinkering with his pride and joy nearly 50 years after it first launched.
I designed what I wanted. It's based on seagoing tugs modified to fit the narrow canals, because I wanted a boat that handles properly and was a bit unusual. And the whole thing has got curves everywhere. There's hardly a straight piece in it. Once I designed it, I then made a model out of a 5-gallon oil drum, 16th scale, because the oil drum was 1/16th the thickness of the quarter plate I was going to use. And then to check the design, see that it looked right, then it sailed all right, floated it on the pond at home and took several photographs so that I could get rid of any scale effects. And I was satisfied. And when they got the job, I took the model and they used that in the construction work.
Fuel tanks are mounted on either side of the passageway, with pumps above to feed the diesel to the engine. And for anyone crewing the boat, to help with getting between locks, there's a classic bike from the 1970s on the wall. There's only one bit of the boat Edwin didn't build himself.
The hull was built by Haylett & Porter down in Norwich. The original cabin was built by my uncle, which was made out of wood. Then in 2010 or thereabouts, the new cabin which was built is completely stainless steel with aluminium cappings. So no corrosion on the top, which is always good. It runs a Gardner 3LW, which isn't the original engine. The original engine was a 4LK, but the 3LW is more suited to canals.
And the engine's in the kitchen?
The engine is right in the centre of the boat, yes. Being a single man, my uncle decided that he would build it for himself to cruise on his own. Therefore, it doesn't really matter where the engine is. As a family, it's a little bit more challenging, but we love it still.
There aren't many people who have the engine in the middle of the boat to start with. That gives you your best balance, improves your steering ability, because you concentrate all the weight in the middle of the boat. So you effectively, your moment of inertia, which is when you turn a corner, the boat's got to move one way or the other, and that's a sideways energy. And the easier it will turn, the less effort you need to do it.
Ferris has many more party tricks up its sleeve. This is the combined horn, exhaust and tunnel lamp enclosure. Have you ever seen a narrowboat tunnel lamp quite like this? The mechanism is driven by a car's windscreen washer motor, apparently. Isn't that just utterly bonkers and yet glorious? Oh, and the exhaust pipes motorise too, so that it doesn't snag when going under low bridges. But the best feature of all, surely, is that this boat can be entirely radio controlled. With a system designed and built by Edwin, of course, the rudder is not just standalone, but has a chain round it inside the hull. It's driven by hydraulics, pressurised by a water pump. This standard controller for model cars sends signals back to Edwin's homebrew receiver, which plugs in when needed.
That's the aerial. The receiver is only a little box in there, and then those switches, they're linked to servos.
It's a mind-boggling setup, and incredibly, much of the fabrication was done in Edwin's back garden.
There's very little on the boat which you can buy off the shelf. My uncle is fond of building stuff wherever he can.
Probably the biggest thing was making the propeller. That's made from a manganese aluminium bronze, which is the stuff that's used on big ships' propellers.
But Ferris isn't the only boat he's built. Also created in the back garden was this little gem, Rivets 5000, the name a very obvious clue as to its construction. It is a proper scaled-down narrowboat, albeit a very short one, and has seats for two people. No slipway or heavy-duty crane required for this launch.
We had a narrowboat, full-length narrowboat, originally. Then we shortened it to 57 foot, and we thought it would be nice to have a dinghy. And instead of just any old dinghy you buy, I decided to make one, and it's a half scale of a narrowboat. Effectively, it's a fore end and a stern end with no middle. The frame, that's all aluminium castings, which were all bolted together. And then the hull itself, the sheeting. Most of it's made from the side of a Midland Red bus, which we bought from a breaker's yard for a few pounds. This is back in 1967. And the fore end was beaten out of a Lagonda saloon door. And the whole lot is riveted together by the original way of hammered rivets. None of this pop rivet or anything like that.
The original engine was an Austin 7 engine with an Austin 7 gearbox. And they used to run a drop skeg and a 17-inch prop. This would enable it to tow a full-size 70-foot narrowboat at 3 miles an hour, which was immensely good fun, apparently. I adopted rivets back 2 or 3 years ago and decided to put a diesel engine in it. And we now have a little Kubota two-cylinder engine with what is now a proper marine gearbox. When I first built it, we put a Robin Reliant gearbox in it, but found the reverse gear was not really up to scratch, so we went for a marine box instead.
Getting in rivets is not for the faint-hearted, and is best done with something firm to hold onto, as Daniel and his cousin David will now demonstrate.
Yes, it's a bit wobbly. It's like having a canoe, essentially. It doesn't have much of a draft on it, so when you get in, you've just got to be very careful where you put your feet. I have come out at the top of Riders Green Locks, trying to get out of the boat. I got launched out the opposite side, which we made for a very wet day, but it's rare, thankfully.
You have to be careful you don't turn it over, because it's like any small dinghy, it's not very stable if you get to one side. But It's fairly straightforward. When I've been on my own, I've often stood up to steer it because that's one of the best ways of doing it.
Of course, one of the advantages of a small narrowboat is that it can be easier to reach more difficult canal locations. And when your boat is this small, it's ideal.
We try and explore the bits of the canals which we can't really get to very easily with our full-size boat. We also like to compete in the BCNS challenge, and we came sixth last year, hoping for a better score this year, and just generally mess about and have some fun.
A lot of the early use of it was with protest cruising on canals that were derelict or semi-derelict and you couldn't get a normal boat through. A particular one was in 1968 when a group of us from the Staffs and Worcester Canal Society went down the lower part of the Cordon Canal from Hazlehurst down to Froghall, which at that time was closed. The water was in there, but none of the locks worked or anything, and we were able to portage round.
Clearly, Rivets has led an eventful life, and it does look immense fun. It also looks immensely loud.
Well, we can't hear a lot when you're running it because it's quite noisy, but everybody smiles and everybody's quite pleased to see it. And when we do stop, there's quite usually quite a few people who are inquiring about how it was built and where it's come from and all that. And it's very good fun.
If you spot Rivets 5000 or Ferris out on the waterways, do be sure to give Dan, Edwin and the rest of the family a wave. We took both boats for a cruise in the pouring rain, and I've compiled that into a vlog which will be the next video on this channel. Thanks for watching. Cheerio.